Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio with your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Today we have with us, returning to the studio, Mike Rinder. Mike, welcome.
Hi, Jeff. Nice to be back.
Mike, I got to tell you, your blog, Something Can Be Done About It, is amazing.
Well, thank you. I try, and you know, there are a lot of people that help. There are a lot of special correspondents that send in material, and that is primarily what that blog consists of, is material sent in from people, and they're searching out and finding things of interest in the world of Scientology.
Mike, on your blog, you cover basically current affairs regarding the Church of Scientology, and that's what we want to discuss today.
Perfect.
And where we begin is last week, top church executives accosted Marty Rathbun at LAX. What went on?
Well, I think that they're... You know, this is somewhat speculation, but it's also based on past experience. I think that Marty has been engaged in things that are creating a perturbance with David Miscavige, and so he has probably issued some sort of directive to those who are left still able to leave the gold base property for any reason. Probably told them, you know, nobody ever takes care of my interests. This guy's running around, he's bad mouthing me. Nobody's sticking up for me. Nobody's out there doing anything to protect my public relations. And he's just, nobody cares about him anyway. And, you know, so you don't have people like that, you know, senior officials from the church going and making a public display without it being very explicitly authorized, and particularly not a public display with respect to Marty Rathbun, and especially not in light of the fact of the ongoing lawsuit in Texas from Monique Rathbun, his wife. This was a really bizarre set of circumstances, and perhaps the best indication that the world inside the bubble of Scientology is becoming increasingly out of touch with the real world. That Miscavige and those three clowns think that they could get away with something like that without it having any blowback is indicative that their mindset is that they are the masters of the universe, that they can just go out and do whatever they want and treat people however they want, even in public places, and that there'll be nothing that comes of it because it's quote unquote the greatest good for the greatest number of dynamics. I mean, I watched Karen's video, and this point about the greatest good for the greatest number of dynamics is something that I've talked about on my blog a number of times, and I think it's a fundamental problem and a fundamental belief of Scientology that leads people to think that they can get away with doing whatever they want. The internet video going viral has proved otherwise yet again, but they won't learn from it. This is just a, you know, observing the dying throes of an organism which is on its last legs and is sort of spasmodically lashing out without really any thought or any hope of accomplishing anything, but just lashing out for the sake of lashing out. I mean, that was one of the more bizarre things I've seen, although it's not new that those sort of things have been being done for a long time. The difficulty for the church at this point is that the world is watching so closely, and that Marty had the presence of mind to simply stand there and record it on video. And now the world gets to see what the senior executives of Scientology are really like. And that was, you know, Jenny Linson is in David Miscavige's valence. For, I can't think of a better word to say than that. She is his, she's a sock puppet. She is, you see in her statements and in her face what a reflection of David Miscavige. What David Miscavige has said to Jenny Linson is what Jenny Linson turns around and says to Marty Rathbun in exactly the same tone. And this isn't the first time you've seen that either, because she, as she's so infamously known as one of the Inch Wives, was on Anderson Cooper doing exactly the same thing, just like Tommy Davis was doing with the media before he departed. It becomes a bit of a circus because you watch these people. And if you've had any direct dealings with David Miscavige, you know that what they are doing and saying is acting out what has been done and said to them.
Mike, thank you for that astonishing description of, you know, what it's like to be in close. These three people are, you know, in my mind, out of touch with reality. The church wants to present itself as being ecclesiastical, and yet this is not how senior ecclesiastical officials should act.
Well, Torquemada would argue with you about that.
Point well taken. Now, two questions for you. One, would this have been done directly out of base, or would the Office of Special Affairs have been on it?
No, the Office of Special Affairs doesn't dictate these sort of things. This is the only way those people were authorized to take that action was because they were authorized directly by David Miscavige.
So was it a bypass of OSA?
Well, everything is a bypass of everybody. There is no such thing as bypass in the Scientology hierarchy. There is David Miscavige, and then there is a bunch of minions that do things for him. So there isn't ever really any bypass of anyone, because nobody really has any job. The only job they have is to do what COB says.
Well, that certainly helps to put things in perspective, because in a dictatorial system, there would be a breakdown of order, which is what we saw here. And at least another question, Mike, what is the aftermath of a video like this? Marty films it, it goes online with now 615,000 views and climbing. What is the aftermath? What happens to the three actors in this scenario?
This is what is so unfortunate, Jeff, is in the first instance, they will be high-fiving. They will have walked away from that and be patting one another on the back and saying what a great job they did, and that they did exactly what COB told them to do. And at the outset, when they first reported back and said, yes, sir, we got right in his face. Yes, we told him nobody cares about him. Yes, we told him, just like you said, we said, blah, 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 it'll be well done. Well, at least someone did something for a change instead of me having to do it all. After a day, 2 days, when it started to become an internet fiasco, then the blame game starts, and now they're probably in trouble for having stupidly allowed him to set up while he was videotaping.
You know, Mike, I was wondering why they didn't abort the operation the very second Marty raises a camera. They should have split and gone in three directions.
Because they're scared. They're scared that if they walked away, then when they called into Miscavige to report back, if they'd said, we didn't do it, sir, because he had a video camera running, he would have started screaming at them for being chicken.
So you're damned if you do, damned if you don't.
All the time.
And that really brings us to another topic that's related, the sorry state of their internet presence. I mean, they're not thinking that Marty could raise a video camera and this could go viral. They didn't have the ability to predict that. They seemingly have no ability to predict the internet.
Well, you're right. They don't have any ability to predict the internet. But what's so funny now is to watch them raising money with the idea that they are briefing their people that the most important communication medium on planet Earth today is the internet, that they can reach everybody on Earth, and that they've got to get their act together in order to be able to reach everybody through the internet. And in their mind, that means they have to buy the KCET studio in Hollywood and then renovate it in order to have material to put on the internet. Well, Marty Rathbun just shot a video that cost nothing and put it on the internet and got more hits than Scientology.org has had in an entire year. So their theory, or the pitch that they're giving to their people about how vital and important the internet is, and we really need to get going on it, and we need to create this content, is silly for a number of reasons. First of all, they keep telling everybody, basically, the internet is really important. Get on it. We need to get on it. So therefore, you need to get on it. And as soon as people get on the internet for Scientology, that is a disaster. There couldn't be anything worse that someone could do than get on the internet. Second thing, they are using it to raise money in order to build this silly studio, which is KCET, but they already have a massive studio at Gold, which is not being utilized. And for a long time, the big hype was, we have the biggest sound stage in California. We've got the state-of-the-art recording equipment. We've got, you know, 7 avid edit bays. We got terabytes of memory. We've got blah, 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 everything. We got everything there. And they do. That's what's so absurd. 75 or 80 miles down the road, they have it all already. But now they're trying to convince people, give us money so we can build another one. And that's just beyond comprehension that people don't go, well, wait a minute. We've been hearing about Gold forever. What happened to Gold? Did that just get closed down?
Mike, thanks for the insight on KCET, because they are using it to raise money endlessly when it represents overcapacity that they don't need. It would be like owning an empty ideal org and raising money to buy more empty ideal orgs.
Oh, it's funny you say that, Jeff.
Now, speaking of underutilized orgs, here in Los Angeles, there what looked like to me as a business person, consolidation or downsizing. What went on with LA org?
Well, it's a really good question, Jeff. I think it's another one of these knee-jerk, you know, all you people, this is Miscavige speaking, all you people can't do anything right. You can never make any org actually expand, because he knows that there isn't an org on planet Earth that is actually expanding. And LA org has been held out as the model, ideal, Saint Hill size, Class 5 org on planet Earth. You know, I've had a number of stories with information that have come in from people about how the staff there just don't get paid, that they don't have anybody on course, their test center is empty, that they don't even have all their staff posts filled, that they busted the senior CS. I mean, it's like a disaster zone, but it's a very, very visible one. So in kind of typical Miscavige style, he's going to overkill it. He decides, okay, I'm going to be the one that's going to handle this now. And so he musical chairs, which is one of his favorite activities. He loves musical chairs, 200 people, and turns LA org into a Seog org. Well, this is a kind of a bizarre step, because if you stand back and look at it, this is the org that they are proclaiming as the model. This is the model for all orgs in Scientology, all Class 5 orgs in Scientology, and it's now Sea Org. It's no longer LA Day and LA Foundation, it's just LA Org, Sea Org, LA Org. Okay, so how is that model going to be duplicated anywhere? It's a very, very strange, but I've come to the conclusion that the reason for it is to be able to say that something is getting done. Because if you look around this year, Jeff, there has been one ideal org open. That's Sydney. That's it in an entire year. This is the single most important program in Scientology. The thing that every staff member, every OT committee, and everybody anywhere is focused on and is not even focused on, obsessed about. That's all they ever talk about. Ideal orgs, ideal orgs, ideal orgs, fundraising for ideal orgs, fundraising for ideal orgs. It's the thing that is happening in Scientology. And he has a problem, because if there are none that he can go yank a ribbon on and make a little video about, then people are noticing, well, what happened? I thought all orgs were supposed to be going ideal, and there aren't any. So then he resorts to, oh, I'm going to go pull a ribbon on the Pacifica Bridge, or I'm going to go pull a ribbon on now the most absurd one of all, the CLO of Europe. Like, that's an ideal org now, the CLO. It's just becoming meaningless, but it's becoming also apparently very desperate. Something has to happen, otherwise there's not going to be any, and then the enthusiasm for the 120 other orgs that are around that are not ideal, that they're trying to make ideal, is just going to die. They're just going to go, you know, we've been working at this for 11 years now. We haven't made it. And apparently nobody else is making it either. So it's not just us. Because that's the method that is used in Scientology to keep people from seeing what they see in their own area and thinking that that reflects what's going on in the whole world. They're told, you are the only ones that are failing. Everybody else is succeeding. And as long as you can keep that fiction alive, you can keep a lot of failing places going on the basis that they must be doing something wrong and everybody else is doing it right. It both gives them hope and it makes them try harder because clearly they're going to be under the gun for failing. But when you see that everybody is failing, and the proof is there's no more videos of ribbon pullings to open these silly ideologues, then you got a problem, or he has a problem. So now you're starting to see these unusual things being done. It advanced orgs that are now ideal. It's CLOs that are ideal. It's buying new advanced orgs in Australia. Like, that the existing AO in Australia is so underutilized, it's not funny. Plus, he's got an AO sitting there in Africa that's been there for like 10 years, purchased, but nothing's happened with it. And another one in Canada that's just growing weeds and mildew, and nothing's happening with them either. So this whole thing is becoming harder and harder to come up with something to present that convinces people that things are going fine everywhere.
Mike, this is a very interesting point I want to focus in on. David Miscavige has bet his reputation and really bet the church on the Ideal Org program. And he began betting in a big, big way in the early 2002, 2003.
Yep.
Now that the momentum has slowed down, and I mean in a big strategic way, this isn't one or two orgs or churches not growing. This is everywhere internationally.
Yep.
He has to create the appearance that there's progress going forward. And he has to do it in the face of the internet, keeping an eye on what's really happening with the orgs. And especially an expert like you, who will not be buffaloed or fooled by church PR. So as you say, he has to resort to unusual solutions such as what he did in Los Angeles. Do you think it would be safe to say, Mike, that the era of the ideal org is coming to an end within the Church of Scientology, or will he maintain the facade?
I think what's going to happen, Jeff, is that we're going to start seeing this expand out to other easier targets. Like, now we're going to start seeing, and he already announced it at the IS, ideal Narconons. And then we'll start seeing some ideal missions, because you can take a few little missions and throw a bit of money at them and turn them into quote unquote ideal missions. And there'll be something to talk about and something to show. It's proven that as long as you have, or he has, something, people just don't pay much attention to what isn't there. They only pay attention to what is there. And they've been so conditioned to believing that if they're told that something is good news and everything's going great, and there's some picture that can go along with it, whether it's a CGI image or a corny stat graph bursting through the roof or a posed shot of children holding Way to Happiness booklets or whatever it is, you can, if you match a statement, things are going great, our expansion is wonderful, it's 47x, it's whatever. Whatever bullshit that he comes up with, and you can put a picture, even if the picture doesn't actually show anything, but it's a picture that's sort of on the subject somehow, people buy it. I mean, look at the hype that was done for this IAS event. This is earth-shattering. It's going to change the world. It's going to turn you upside down. It's going to blah, 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 blah. And yet the event is nothing. Like, nothing happened at that event. Those knock-anons that he announced had already been announced at an IAS event in March. I put it on my blog. I accepted the paragraph of Sherman speak that he had blubbered out at some IAS briefing that he did in March in Los Angeles, where he said all exactly the same stuff. There was nothing earth-shattering or new or a big change about that. And they did a couple more PSAs and some DVDs. That's what happens at every IAS event every year. Same old crap. And yet it's hyped as the biggest, greatest thing, but the people got shown some pictures, they got told everything was great, and they walk out of there and go, yippee, hooray, everything's wonderful. So my prediction is the orgs are going to like limp along. They will try and keep that going, but we'll see more and more of this other stuff, ideal other shit. And it will be whatever it is that's available. That can, I mean, we'll probably start seeing ideal counseling groups and ideal study tech tutor groups and just anything. And they'll just keep the word going ideal, and it'll make it appear that the ideal program is really going along great.
Yes, everything is fully ideal. And that the whole concept of ideal, it doesn't even really mean anything. It's becoming a meaningless statement to say an ideal this or an ideal that. When you look at the real world metrics, and you measure them on your site every day, Tony Ortega does.
Yeah.
For example, here at the recent IAS, as you posted, they started to rent the shrine. They went down to the Bonaventure. They wind up on L. Ron Hubbard Way. Can you tell our listeners how many people fill these respective halls and how the shrink happened?
The shrine holds about 6,500 people. The Bonaventure holds about 3,000. Although it could be, that's the maximum, and it can be broken down by putting up petitions. L. Ron Hubbard Way, who knows? I guess you could cram a couple of thousand in there, but you can't ever really even tell how many people are there. This is a very, very significant indicia, Jeff, of the state of Scientology, because it's the same thing at Flag. The massive mecca building, the wondrous, incredible, astonishing, everybody's been waiting 10 years for Superpower and the running program, and it's booming Scientology, and Gattu is booming Flag, and it's like, it's just like nothing has ever been seen before, and yet they can't even get the Ruth Eckert Hall for the IAS event, and that only holds 2,300 people. And if you listen to Flag and the PR that they pump out to the local media, they say that they've got 1,500 Sea Org members, they have 2,000 public here at any given time, and there are 12,000 Scientologists in the Tampa Bay area. Now, how they couldn't fill up a 2,300-seat auditorium is perhaps indicative that really the idea that there's this big booming scene happening is not. So you have no ideologues being made. You have these events shrinking and the attendance shrinking constantly. I've published now a number of times the completions lists from various magazines, from Advanced Orgs and Flag to the recent one a couple of days ago, LA Org. They're not getting anybody moving anywhere on the bridge. They get all excited if they have two people that complete the purification program. This is in, you know, these ideal orgs. They get all want to shout from the rooftops that they had another completion on the survival rundown objectives, or that they had someone who completed a level of auditor training. And meantime, the statements are that planetary clearing is being made a reality with ideal orgs and GAT2. Well, planetary clearing is being made an unreality because there isn't any clears being made anywhere. I mean, South Coast Mission said that they've made 8. That's more than any other org in the world, probably, in the last year. Jeff, the LA Org magazine, the new big super duper magazine with the RTC rep up there prominent, they didn't have a single clear, not one. This is the before, obviously, the Sea Org moved in and took over, but this was the model St. Hill size ideal class 5 org on planet Earth in the center of the largest concentration of Scientologists anywhere on the planet, and they didn't make one clear. And that magazine is probably has accumulated, based on looking at the other figures, their completions over between 4 and 6 months. So in 6 months, they haven't made a single clear. Wow, that's really clearing the planet.
No, and as you mentioned, I mean, at this rate, they'll take hundreds of thousands of years. But really, it's a scathing indictment of David Miscavige's leadership, because the church, by design, is, you know, is obviously built to make clears and OTs, correct?
Well,
you know,
deliver in
services.
Theory, yes.
Well, yes, yeah, what I mean. But the disjunct between reality and hyperbole, that's what's really pulling at church members, I think. What's causing people to leave the church is this tension between reality and PR.
Yeah, I agree with you, Jeff. I think that for the most part, the people that ultimately leave the church are the ones that have some experience that causes them, you know, it's the straw that breaks the camel's back. Something that they go, you know what, this is just too much. I'm not doing this anymore. And their initial reaction is to address it as being whatever happened was off policy or out tech. That's the framework in which people view whether something is good or bad in Scientology when they're inside Scientology. They only look at it and go, this is out tech, this is off policy. They're not looking at it from in a larger context, or, you know, the way that someone who has been outside of that bubble for a long time looks. They go, you know what, this regging is off policy. They don't look at it and go, wait a minute, people are being ripped off because they're taking money for nothing and not blah, 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 blah. They go, wait a minute, there is a policy letter that says that you're supposed to reg for services and that blah, 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 blah. And there is another policy letter that says, you know, financial planning, never spend more than you make. And so they compare it to that. So it's always useful when trying to figure out how to reach those people that are sitting inside the bubble to be able to compare what they see or what is happening to what the policy or the tech expectation is, because they are not up to yet realizing that there is oftentimes a much simpler and I guess more pragmatic view of some of this stuff. You know, this is just ridiculous. This is bullshit. This is not right. Not, well, this violates HCOPL, blah, 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 blah. It's like a really a lot simpler than that. You're taking money from people and you're putting enormous pressure on people to give you money that they really cannot afford to give you for something that you, and you're telling them you're going to spend it on X and you're really not going to do it. That's not off policy. That's fraud.
Mike, you make an excellent point, and one that's very serious. Yes, when you speak to people in the church, you talk about off policy, out tech. And that's why I think Debbie Cook's email was so powerful.
Correct.
She spoke directly to people in the church the way they could listen.
Correct.
And this is crucial, especially for people who are Scientology watchers who don't know the culture. If you don't know how to culturally speak, people are still in the church, they won't hear you. And this is why I think your blog is valuable, because it communicates, but it also has, it lets them feel the dissonance between what they suspect versus how they're supposed to think.
Yeah. Well, you know, Jeff, I don't believe that anybody that is in the church would be reading really in the church would be reading my blog, because I think that the, you know, from what I've heard from people who have left, you know, Marty Rathbun and Mike Rinder and Karen De La Carrier are like the three horsemen of the apocalypse, the bubonic plague, Ebola, the ISIS, and everything else all rolled at Sykes and major media all rolled into one. And so anything that we say directly to those people, they do not pay any attention to. It's all just a maze of thought stopping. But what I do believe happens is that the information that is provided by me or by Karen or by you or by Tony or any of a number of sources of information is information that people who are still connected to people inside the bubble now have to be able to make known to those people, someone that they might listen to, someone that they, you know, last year was sitting in the HGC waiting room with them, bemoaning their fate about how they've run out of money and, you know, can't do another 6-month check, and who they haven't seen a written declare on. But if that person has the information that they've gleaned from listening or watching Karen's videos or reading my blog or looking at Tony Ortega, they've got a bunch of factual information that they can then present to these people and explain to them. That's my view of where this is at. I don't think any of those people really listen to me. I don't think if I stood outside the Fort Harrison and stopped people on the street and could engage them in a conversation, that they would hear one word that I said.
No, and they can't hear it. They won't hear it. They refuse to hear it.
Right.
And this is really no different than a Christian not wanting to hear an atheist's opinion of Jesus.
Correct.
I don't want to hear it. I have no use for it. Because their identity is threatened.
Yep.
You know, who they're being is threatened. And that's a very crucial point. Changing gears a little bit, Mike, I want to ask you, and our mutual good friend Michael Bennett flew over the opening of the superpower flag building that David Miscavige opened.
Yep.
Which was a tremendous, tremendous thing to do. And I'm so glad you and Michael Bennett did it. Because really, it gave those of us out here who weren't at flag eyes in the sky.
Right.
When you were over the grand opening, what was your sense when you saw the people below? What went on that helicopter ride?
Okay, well, I guess, Jeff, that the first and most striking thing about it was that there were just not that many people there. As I described earlier, if as the church claims there are 12,000 people in the Tampa Bay area who are Scientologists, and there is, you know, 1,500 staff and 2,000 people on lines, and all the people that have been called in from all over the world for this grand opening and the IAS event and everything else that was all happening at that time at FLAG, that turnout was really, really pathetic. They gave some kooky number of 10,273 and a quarter people, and it was ridiculous. I mean, I've seen many, many crowds in my time, and I at the time when we were up in the helicopter, I said that I figured there was between 4,000 and 5,000 people there. Other people who were around said that there were many less. But the second thing that was most striking to me was I knew the panic that was setting in below, because there were two other helicopters up there circling the same event. One of them was the Tampa Bay Times. The other one was the church helicopter. The church had rented a helicopter for the Gold Chute crew to shoot the event from above. Of course, nobody ever saw any of that footage, because if they had, that footage would have confirmed that what Mike and I had said and sent, which was not anything close to the 10,273 and a quarter people that they said were there. Even when we were in the air, the pilot of the church hired helicopter started saying, well, the event is going to begin in 5 minutes. All all air traffic is to leave the area. They tried to,
really?
They tried to to act like they were some sort of, you know, police in the sky or something.
Yeah, and the FAA.
and the pilot of our helicopter says to me, "Should we leave?" I said, "Are you kidding? No way." Just because they say that we should leave, they don't have any authority over us. He said, "You're right." He said, "I figured that you'd say that, but I felt sort of obliged to ask." I said, "No way are we leaving. In fact, can you go lower? How low can..." I knew that we had to stay above 500 feet. I said, "Like, when this event starts, I want you right over the top. Don't go away. That's when we want to be close. You know, they're worried about the noise. I'm not. I don't care about their noise problems. I'm more interested in getting good footage." So he was totally up for it. We had explained to him what this was all about. And of course, as soon as you say anything to anybody about Scientology, they stop with their own little stories. "Oh, yeah, well, I knew this guy and blah, 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 and he was a blah, 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 blah." And everybody's got a story or an opinion about Scientology, and they're never good. They just are not ever good. They don't ever have anything nice to say. Our pilot says, "Oh, yeah, I saw that CNN program with Anderson Cooper. Oh, my God, who were those women?" That's just how it is now. It's sort of unfortunate, but on the other hand, it's well-deserved because that is who they are.
Well, of course, and to be very blunt, we have Jenny Linson, senior church official, saying to Marty Rathbun, quote, "Nobody gives a fuck about you," unquote. And I thought, wait a minute, Miss Linson. You're the church that says something can be done about it. Yet in real life, you're saying nobody gives a fuck about you. So which is it?
Yeah.
You know, what are you really doing, Church of Scientology? In the final analysis, are you only raising money and engaging in humanity, or do you stand for anything? Do you mean anything? I frankly was disturbed by the LAX event for three reasons. One, that it was a U.S. high security airport. Why would you go in there with the intent to disturb? Two, we're tax-exempt dollars spent. And three, the things they said to Marty.
Yeah.
I think this event, this LAX thing, may prove to be pivotal. Do you think it'll be a turning point for the church?
I'm not sure that'll be a turning point for the church, Jeff. I mean, but it's certainly significant. And it's significant because of the fact that it's sitting out there and it's never going away, and they're never going to live it down. And like the inch wives, that is going to get pulled out over and over and over. And everybody that does reporting on Scientology from here on out, if they're doing video TV reporting,
yeah,
that clips from that are going to be used over and over and over. They've become the new squirrel bust. And worse than the squirrel busters, because at least there was, not at least, the church could claim some distance from the squirrel busters. Oh, they're just, you know, public Scientologists. They're out there, you know, putting up, you know, dealing with or trying to have their freedom of speech and blah, 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 blah. No, Jenny Linson, Mark Yeager, and Dave Bloomberg are three of the most senior officials in Scientology. They're right below and answer directly to David Miscavige. Now, do they really have any authority? No. The only authority they have is to do what he tells them. But nevertheless, they are, if someone could corner anybody in the Church of Scientology, a PR, and get them to actually have a press interaction, and they said, "Okay, well, where's Heber Gentsch? Oh, he's, is he still the president? Oh, yes, he's still the president. Well, who's the CEO of CMON? Who's the WDC chairman? Oh, well, that's Mark Yeager. Well, who's the..." I mean, literally, they would be offering those people as the most senior executives in Scientology, because they don't have anybody else to offer, so those would be the guys. And they are the ones that have been around for a long time. But they certainly can't say they're just nobodies.
No, not at all. In fact, that's what makes their behaviors shocking, that responsible officials would behave in this way. Mike, you knew the three people at LAX, Jenny Linson, Mark Yeager, Dave Bloomberg.
Yep.
You know them personally. You've worked with them. How did they seem to you physically, spiritually? To me, Jenny seemed very tired and stressed. What was your reaction to seeing their faces?
They looked like I looked in when I was on the BBC Panorama show just before I left in 2007. They look like people who have been sleep deprived, food deprived, and stressed out by being told that they're absolute walking SP, small peanut Thetan, nobody DBs. And that's what they've had a diet of that for, you know, probably 10 years now of being told that pretty much every day. And now that's what they look like. Mark and David, to me, looked sickly, gaunt, drawn, gray, just like I looked. That's how I looked in the BBC and when I was in London. Jenny, on the other hand, looked puffy, black bags under her eyes, attempted to cover up her state with a bunch of makeup and failed. She, to me, looked more like someone who'd contracted rabies. And I don't mean she's just crazy. I mean, literally going actually mad, becoming certifiably insane.
Oh, I know what you mean. She looked incensed, raving. And that's what really gave it a lot of punch. And Jenny didn't walk away after the initial encounter. She returned twice.
Right.
She goes back like a shark for more. Now, if the intended effect was supposed to cave in Marty, was that what it was supposed to do? Was Marty supposed to capitulate and...
Yes.
Or what were they trying to provoke a reaction like Tommy Davis got out of John Sweeney?
Yes. Two things. One, it was Miscavige has this little mantra about the, and it comes from an HCOB where it says that the way to deal with an SP is to tell them no, and if you tell them no, they shatter. And so they go around telling him no. I mean, that was the same mantra that I got in the parking lot of the doctors. Stop committing suppressive acts. Stop committing suppressive acts. Stop doing what you're doing. And nobody cares about you. No, you're a nothing. You're a nobody. And that part of it is this ill-conceived theory that if you tell someone that they're to stop committing suppressive acts against Scientology, suddenly they're going to come to their senses, repent, break down in tears, and say, please, can you take me back and salvage me? The second part of it is the continuous goading and you can't even talk and you know this. And yet, that is to attempt to get some sort of a reaction of a lashing out, like shoving or yelling back or whatever, so that could be used in some fashion to prove that Marty Rathbun is really a lunatic who's out to and poses a physical threat or a danger to any Scientologist or some, you know, bizarre theory like that. Who knows what it would have been, but it doesn't matter because he didn't go for it.
No, in fact, it was extraordinary. Marty was a pacifist. He acted in a very pacifist way.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the lesson for everyone they can take away, if you're approached by angry Church of Scientology cult members who are screaming at you about your crimes, you should simply stay calm and get it on video.
Absolutely. Best advice there is.
Of course, because you're not going to win by engaging them. You'll only look foolish. And they win if you engage them.
Correct.
The advantage Marty had was he just did not react. You know, spiritually, he didn't react. And in fact, he politely said, would you people please move on? And I thought this demonstrated such a mastery on his part. He didn't need retribution. He didn't need to argue. He didn't need to debate. He simply asked them to please move on.
Right.
They didn't know what to do with that, Mike.
Yeah, of course.
But listen, look at what that says spiritually. They didn't know what to do with someone who didn't want to fight them.
I understand that, Jeff. It's not just look at what it says spiritually. It says look at what it is from the perspective of, are these people, you know, if you asked them or asked someone in the church, are these people grade zero releases? Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, golden age of tech, too, grade zero releases. And yet they cannot hold a conversation with anybody on any topic at any time about anything. They can only parrot. They're parrots.
Mike, what's your view of the state of the Church of Scientology today?
Well, Jeff, I think I'd probably sum it up by saying it truly is the Titanic who has, and it's hit the iceberg some time ago, and Captain Dave is frantically on the bridge trying to tell everybody that all is well and there's no need to panic and please don't abandon my ship because we're not going down. And the inevitable is being observed from outside, and it is going down, and it's heading for a very watery grave, and it's not too far away. It's beyond repair, but it hasn't yet sunk below the surface. But it's heading there.
I agree with you completely on that description of the church. The ship is straight up and vertical, not expansion. That's an important distinction. The ship itself is straight up and vertical, and we're going down. So, you know, I think it's past the point of deck chairs even. Mike Rinder, thank you for spending time with us on Surviving Scientology Radio. Always love having you on the